Hey, fellow math explorer. Are you looking for help with your real analysis course? Well, you've come to the right place. This is Real Analysis Study Help for Baby Rudin, Part 1.4, Properties of the Supremum and Infimum, Sups and Infs. It's an overview of an article I wrote at my blog, infinityisreallybig.com, back on April Fool's Day of 2021, called Properties of the Supremum. In that article, my main goal was to go through the first really tricky proof in Baby Rudin, that of Theorem 1.11, which is about showing that ordered sets with the least upper bound property also have the greatest lower bound property. A couple other properties are proved as well, including the fact that if A and B are sets of real numbers that are both bounded above, then the supremum acts like an additive operator on their sum A plus B, which consists of all sums of numbers in A with numbers in B. The sup of A plus B equals the sup of A plus the sup of B. In this video, I want to go through both of those proofs to help you understand them. And I've got a bonus. I want to go through the proof of exercise 5 at the end of chapter 1 in Baby Rudin. As usual, I've got some interesting mathematical animations to show you along the way to help you understand the concepts. But let's start by reviewing the definition of the supremum along with a few basic examples. Given a totally ordered set S, such as the real numbers, and a subset E, which is bounded above, an element beta in S is the supremum of E, written beta equals sup of E if, number one, beta is an upper bound of E, so every x in E is less than or equal to beta. And number two, any element of S that is strictly less than beta is not an upper bound of E. In other words, beta is less than or equal to any other upper bound of E. It is the least upper bound of E. The definition of the infimum, or inf, of a set E which is bounded below is completely analogous, but instead of getting the least upper bound of E, we would be getting the greatest lower bound of E. In the previous video, part 1.3, we considered both basic examples of sups and infs and a pretty challenging example that was pretty interesting as well. You'll want to make sure you watch that. In this video, however, we'll keep our examples more basic. And you can't get more basic than thinking about intervals. Assume A and B are real numbers with A less than B. Then the sup of the open interval from A to B is the same as the sup of the closed interval from A to B. It's the right endpoint B. In addition, the inf of the open interval from A to B is also the same as the inf of the closed interval from A to B. It's the left endpoint A. This Mathematica code that you see here will illustrate these facts for the case of the open interval from 2 to 5. Here is that interval shaded in blue. We see beta set to be 5.25 initially. That is not the sup yet. It is an upper bound, but it's not the least upper bound. If beta is just barely less than 5, it is no longer an upper bound of this set. It's only when beta equals 5 exactly that we get the least upper bound, the sup of E. On the other hand, the greatest lower bound, the inf of this set, is when beta equals 2. If beta is less than 2, it's a lower bound, but not the greatest lower bound. If beta is bigger than 2, it's no longer a lower bound of this open interval from 2 to 5. As we work toward our look at the proof of Theorem 1.11 in Baby Rudin, a couple of definitions are in order. First of all, an ordered set S is said to have the least upper bound property if every non-empty subset of S, which is bounded above, has a supremum in S. It turns out that the set of real numbers has the least upper bound property, but the set of rational numbers does not. Analogously, an ordered set S is said to have the greatest lower bound property if every non-empty subset of S which is bounded below has an infimum in S. The real numbers, once again, have the greatest lower bound property, whereas the rational numbers do not. A question we could then ask and try to answer is this. Does every ordered set S with the least upper bound property also have the greatest lower bound property? Note that we can certainly ask and try to answer this question without reference to the real numbers at all. Theorem 1.11 in Baby Rudin answers this question in the affirmative. Yes, every set with the least upper bound property has the greatest lower bound property. You can see it's a pretty long statement. Let's break it down. Suppose S is an ordered set with the least upper bound property. Also suppose that B is a non-empty subset of S which is bound below. Therefore, there will be a non-empty set L of lower bounds of B, and we can conclude that the supremum of L exists in S, and this supremum is also the infimum of B. In particular, inf of B exists in S, so S has the greatest lower bound property. In my article at infinityisreallybig.com, I take the time to break down my thought process for the proof. I talk about the givens in the situation, the must-shows, and how to connect the premises to the conclusions. In this video, let's instead look at a couple related examples to make the ideas more concrete. We're going to consider S to be the set of real numbers, and here in example 1, let B be the set of all numbers 1 over n as n ranges over the natural numbers. So this includes 1, 1 half, 1 third, 1 fourth, 1 fifth, etc. Then L, the set of all lower bounds of B, if you think about it carefully, will be the set of all numbers less than or equal to 0, the interval from negative infinity to 0, including the right endpoint 0. And we can also say that the inf of B and the sup of L are the same and they are both the number 0. In the second example, I just add one more point, the number 0, to the set B. The set L stays the same, it is still all the numbers less than or equal to 0, and the inf of B and the sup of L are still also 0. The output of this Mathematica code will help us visualize this. We see the first example, where B is the set 1, 1 half, 1 third, 1 fourth. Those are the blue dots that you see. L is the set of all lower bounds of B. Again, that consists of all the real numbers less than or equal to 0. That's colored green. And the red dot, when we move it to the right spot, will be the sup of L, which is also the inf of B. What is that right spot? It is the number 0 right there. Alpha equals 0 is indeed the supremum of L, the least upper bound of L. It is also the infimum of B, the greatest lower bound of B. Now let's work through a polished proof of Theorem 1.11. The set B is assumed to be bounded below. Therefore, it has at least one lower bound, and the set L of all lower bounds of B is nonempty. That set L must also be bounded above, in fact, by any element of B. The ordered set S is assumed to have the least upper bound property in the hypotheses of our theorem. Therefore, the supremum of L exists in S, call it alpha. If we were given any element little b in capital B that was less than alpha, by definition, B would not be an upper bound of L because alpha is the least upper bound of L. Therefore, alpha must be less than or equal to any element little b in capital B. In other words, alpha must be a lower bound of B, which also happens to imply that alpha is an element of L. Continuing, we also want to show that alpha is the greatest lower bound of B. If gamma is some other lower bound of B, then by definition gamma would be an L, but wait a minute, alpha is the sup of L. Therefore, gamma is less than or equal to alpha. In other words, alpha is indeed the greatest lower bound of B. It is the inf of B. Therefore, the inf of B exists in S. We have proved that if S has the least upper bound property, it also has the greatest lower bound property. Next, we take the time to note another property of sups and infs that happens to be the content of exercise 5 in chapter 1 of Baby Rudin. Let capital A be a non-empty set of real numbers which is bounded below. And note that since the real numbers satisfy the greatest lower bound property, the inf of A will exist. Define a new set, negative A, to be the set of all additive inverses of the elements in capital A, the set of all negative little a as little a varies over capital A. Then the sup of negative capital A exists, and in fact it equals the negative of the inf of A. It is the additive inverse of the inf of A. Let's consider a simple example to illustrate this. Let capital A be the closed interval from negative 2 to 3. Then negative A, the set of all additive inverses of the elements of A, would be the closed interval from negative 3 to 2. You can see then that the sup of negative A would be 2, while the additive inverse of the inf of A will also be 2. Negative inf of A equals 2. This Mathematica code that you see here can be used to illustrate this example. When I run it and then play it, I see the closed interval from negative 2 to 3 being transformed by reflection across the origin to the closed interval from negative 3 to 2. We can also see the point x that started out at 1.5 get transformed to the point negative x at negative 1.5. And with regard to the statement in exercise 5, the inf of a, which was negative 2, is the opposite of the supremum of negative a, which is positive 2. Now let's work through the proof of this exercise. Remember, capital A is assumed to be bounded below. Let beta be a lower bound of capital A so that beta is less than or equal to every element of capital A. Multiplying both sides of this inequality by negative 1 implies that negative A is less than or equal to negative beta for all little a in capital A. In other words, negative beta, the additive inverse of beta, is an upper bound of the set negative capital A. Since the set of real numbers satisfies the least upper bound property, we know that the sup of negative A exists in R. In fact, if beta equals the inf of A, which exists because R also satisfies the greatest lower bound property, we claim that the sup of negative A equals negative beta, the additive inverse of beta. Let negative little a be an arbitrary element of negative capital A. then little a is an element of capital A, and since beta is the inf of capital A, we can say that beta is less than or equal to little a. Multiplying both sides of that last inequality by negative 1 allows us to conclude that negative a is less than or equal to negative beta. In other words, negative beta is an upper bound of negative capital A because negative little a was an arbitrary element of negative capital A. Yes, it does kind of feel like you're running around in logical circles, but take the time to figure it out. It really is understandable when you take the time. Remember what we're trying to do. We're trying to show that negative beta, which is negative of the inf of capital A, is the sup of negative capital A. So if we assume gamma is less than negative beta, our goal is to show that gamma is not an upper bound of negative capital A. Assuming that gamma is less than negative beta implies, by multiplying both sides by negative 1, that beta is less than negative gamma. But wait a minute, beta is the greatest lower bound of capital A. So if beta is less than negative gamma, there must be some little a in capital A that is between beta and negative gamma. Once again, we use the trick of multiplying both sides of an inequality by negative 1 to now conclude that gamma must be less than negative little a must be less than negative beta, which is the additive inverse of the inf of capital A. Hang on, we're in the home stretch of the proof now. Since gamma is less than negative little a, this means gamma is not an upper bound of negative capital A. But gamma was an arbitrary real number less than negative beta. It's not an upper bound of negative capital A, therefore negative beta must be the least upper bound of negative capital A. It must be the sup of negative capital A. In other words, the sup of negative capital A is the additive inverse of the inf of A, QED. Our last task of this video is to understand why the supremum is what you would call an additive set function on sets of real numbers which are bounded above. Let capital A and capital B be non-empty sets of real numbers, which are both bounded above. Define capital A plus capital B to be the set of all possible sums of elements from capital A and capital B. The set of all little a plus little b, as little a varies over capital A and little b varies over capital B. Then the sup of capital A plus capital B exists, and it equals the sum of the sup of A with the sup of B. Before looking at the proof of this fact, let's consider a simple example to illustrate it. Suppose capital A is the closed interval from 2 to 3, and suppose capital B is the open interval from 4 to 5. You can double check that the set capital A plus capital B is the open interval from 6 to 8. Note that the sup of capital A plus capital B is 8, which is 3 plus 5, which is the sup of capital A plus the sup of capital B. Here's Mathematica code and output that will illustrate this. You can see capital A is in red, that's the closed interval from 2 to 3. Capital B is in blue, that's the open interval from 4 to 5. And capital A plus capital B is the open interval from 6 to 8, colored in pink. I also have black dots at A equals 2.75 and B equals 4.75 that can be added together to give you A plus B, which is 7.5, which is an element of capital A plus capital B. Once again, the sup of capital A plus capital B is its right endpoint 8. That is the sum of the right endpoints of capital A and capital B. Now let's work our way through the proof. Since capital A and capital B are sets of real numbers which are both bounded above, we know that the sup of A and sup of B exist in R. Call the sup of A alpha and the sup of B beta. Our goal is to show that the sup of A plus B equals alpha plus beta. In other words, we must show that alpha plus beta is the least upper bound of the set capital A plus capital B. So let's start by showing that alpha plus beta is an upper bound of capital A plus capital B. Let little a plus little b be an arbitrary element of capital A plus capital B. It's assumed here that little a is in capital A and little b is in capital B. Then little a is less than or equal to alpha and little b is less than or equal to beta, since alpha is an upper bound of capital A and beta is an upper bound of capital B. Adding these two inequalities allows us to say that little a plus little b is less than or equal to alpha plus beta. In other words, alpha plus beta is an upper bound of capital A plus capital B. But why is alpha plus beta the least upper bound of capital A plus capital B? If we could show that any element less than alpha plus beta is not an upper bound of capital A plus capital B, we would be done. So start by assuming that C is an arbitrary real number less than alpha plus beta. That would imply that alpha plus beta minus C is a positive number. Call it epsilon. Since epsilon is positive, I can say that epsilon over 2 is also positive. That means alpha minus epsilon over 2 would be less than alpha, and beta minus epsilon over 2 would be less than beta. In other words, that leads us to conclude that alpha minus epsilon over 2 is not an upper bound of capital A, and beta minus epsilon over 2 is not an upper bound of capital B. But what does that mean? That means there exists an element A prime in capital A, and an element B prime in capital B, such that A prime is between alpha minus epsilon over 2 and alpha, and B prime is between beta minus epsilon over 2 and beta. But this means the sum, A prime plus B prime, is an element of capital A plus capital B. It also means, by adding inequalities again, that A prime plus B prime is between alpha plus beta minus epsilon and alpha plus beta. But wait a minute, alpha plus beta minus epsilon is our element C, our arbitrary element less than alpha plus beta that we started with. This means C is not an upper bound of capital A plus capital B. Thus, alpha plus beta is indeed the least upper bound of capital A plus capital B. It equals the sup of capital A plus capital B. QED. Thanks for watching.